The Law of Success, Lesson 8, Self-Control. You can do it if you believe you can. In the preceding lesson, you learned the value of enthusiasm. You also learned how to generate enthusiasm and how to transmit its influence to others through the principle of suggestion. You come now to the study of self-control, through which you may direct your enthusiasm to constructive ends. Without self-control, enthusiasm resembles the unharnessed lightning of an electrical storm. It may strike anywhere. It may destroy life and property. Enthusiasm is the vital quality that arouses you to action, while self-control is the balance wheel that directs your action so that you will build up and not tear down. To be a person who is well-balanced, you must be a person in whom enthusiasm and self-control are equalized. A survey which I have just completed of the 160,000 adult inmates of the penitentiaries of the United States discloses the startling fact that 92% of these unfortunate men and women are in prison because they lacked the necessary self-control to direct their energies constructively. Read the foregoing paragraph again. It is authentic, and it is startling. It is a fact that the majority of a man's griefs come about through lack of self-control. The Holy Scriptures are full of admonition in support of self-control. They even urge us to love our enemies and to forgive those who injure us. The law of non-resistance runs like a golden cord through the Bible. Study the records of those whom the world calls great and observe that every one of them possesses this quality of self-control. For example, study the characteristics of our own immortal Lincoln. In the midst of his most trying hours, he exercised patience, poise, and self-control. These were some of the qualities which made him the great man that he was. He found disloyalty in some of the members of his cabinet, but for the reason that this disloyalty was toward him personally, and because those in whom he found it had qualities which made them valuable to his country, Lincoln exercised self-control and disregarded the objectionable qualities. How many men do you know who have self-control to equal this? In language more forceful than it was polished, Billy Sunday exclaimed from the pulpit, "There is something as rotten as hell about the man who is always trying to show some other fellow up." I wonder if the devil didn't yell, "Amen, brother," when Billy made that statement. However, self-control becomes an important factor in this reading course on the Law of Success, not so much because lack of it works hardships on those who become its victims, as for the reason that those who do not exercise it suffer the loss of a great power which they need in their struggle for achievement of their definite chief aim. If you neglect to exercise self-control, you are not only likely to injure others, but you are sure to injure yourself. During the early part of my public career, I discovered what havoc lack of self-control was playing in my life. And this discovery came about through a very commonplace incident. I believe it not out of place here to digress by making the statement that most of the great truths of life are wrapped up in the ordinary, commonplace events of everyday life. This discovery taught me one of the most important lessons I have ever learned. It came about in this way. One day, in the building in which I had my office, the janitor and I had a misunderstanding. This led to a most violent form of mutual dislike between us. As a means of showing his contempt for me, this janitor would switch off the electric lights of the building when he knew that I was there alone at work in my study. This happened on several occasions until I finally decided to strike back. My opportunity came one Sunday when I came to my study to prepare an address that I had to deliver the following night. I had hardly seated myself at my desk when off went the lights. I jumped to my feet and ran toward the basement of the building where I knew I would find the janitor. When I arrived, I found him busily engaged, shoveling coal into the furnace and whistling as though nothing unusual had happened. Without ceremony, I pitched into him, and for 5 minutes I hurled adjectives at him which were hotter than the fire that he was feeding. Finally, I ran out of words and had to slow down. Then he straightened himself up, looked back over his shoulder, and in a calm, smooth tone of voice that was full of poise and self-control, and with a smile on his face that reached from ear to ear, he said, "Why, you all's just a little bit excited this morning, ain't you?" That remark cut as though it had been a stiletto. Imagine my feelings as I stood there before an illiterate man who could neither read nor write, but who despite his handicap had defeated me in a duel that had been fought on grounds, and with a weapon, of my own choice. My conscience pointed an accusing finger at me. I knew that not only had I been defeated, but, what was worse, I knew that I was the aggressor and that I was in the wrong, which only served to intensify my humiliation. Not only did my conscience point an accusing finger at me, but it placed some very embarrassing thoughts in my mind. It mocked me and it tantalized me. There I stood, a boasted student of advanced psychology, an exponent of the Golden Rule philosophy, having at least a fair acquaintance with the works of Shakespeare, Socrates, Plato, Emerson, and the Bible. While facing me stood a man who knew nothing of literature or of philosophy, but who had, despite this lack of knowledge, whipped me in a battle of words. I turned and went back to my office as rapidly as I could go. There was nothing else for me to do. As I began to think the matter over, I saw my mistake. But, true to nature, I was reluctant to do that which I knew must be done to right the wrong. I knew that I would have to apologize to that man before I could place myself at peace in my own heart, much less with him. Finally, I made up my mind to go back down to the basement and suffer this humility which I knew I had to undergo. The decision was not easily reached, nor did I reach it quickly. I started down, but I walked more slowly than I had when I went down the first trip. I was trying to think how I would make the second approach so as to suffer the least humiliation possible. When I got to the basement, I called to the janitor to come over to the door. In a calm, kindly tone of voice, he asked, "What do you wish this time?" I informed him that I had come back to apologize for the wrong I had done, if he would permit me to do so. Again, that smile spread all over his face as he said, "For the love of the Lord, you don't have to apologize. Nobody heard you except these four walls and you and me. I ain't going to tell it, and I know you ain't going to tell it, so just forget it." And that remark hurt me more than his first one, for he had not only expressed a willingness to forgive me, but he had actually indicated his willingness to help me cover the incident up, so it would not become known and do me an injury. But I walked over to him and took him by the hand. I shook with more than my hand. I shook with my heart. And as I walked back to my office, I felt good for having summoned the courage with which to right the wrong I had done. This is not the end of the story. It is only the beginning. Following this incident, I made a resolution that I would never again place myself in a position in which another man, whether he be an illiterate janitor or a man of letters, could humiliate me because I had lost my self-control. Following that resolution, a remarkable change began to take place in me. My pen began to take on greater power. My spoken words began to carry greater weight. I began to make more friends and fewer enemies among men of my acquaintance. The incident marked one of the most important turning points of my life. It taught me that no man can control others unless he first controls himself. It gave me a clear conception of the philosophy back of these words, "Whom the gods would destroy, they first make mad." It also gave me a clear conception of the law of non-resistance and helped me interpret many passages of the Holy Scriptures bearing on the subject of this law as I had never before interpreted them. This incident placed in my hands the passkey to a storehouse of knowledge that is illuminating and helpful in all that I do. And later in life, when enemies sought to destroy me, it gave me a powerful weapon of defense that has never failed me. Lack of self-control is the average salesman's most damaging weakness. The prospective buyer says something that the salesman does not wish to hear, and if he has not this quality of self-control, he will strike back with a counter-remark that is fatal to his sale. In one of the large department stores of Chicago, I witnessed an incident that illustrated the importance of self-control. A long line of women were in front of the complaint desk, telling their troubles and the store's faults to the young woman in charge. Some of the women were angry and unreasonable, and some of them made very ugly remarks. The young woman at the desk received the disgruntled women without the slightest sign of resentment at their remarks. With a smile on her face, she directed these women to the proper departments with such charming grace and poise that I marveled at her self-control. Standing just back of her was another young woman who was making notations on slips of paper and passing them in front of her as the women in the line unburdened their troubles. These slips of paper contained the gist of what the women in the line were saying, minus the vitriolic coloring and the anger. The smiling young woman at the desk who was hearing the complaints was stone deaf. Her assistant supplied her with all the necessary facts through those slips of paper. I was so impressed with the plan that I sought the manager of the store and interviewed him. He informed me that he had selected a deaf woman for one of the most trying and important positions in the store for the reason that he had not been able to find any other person with sufficient self-control to fill the place. As I stood and watched that line of angry women, I observed what pleasant effect the smile of the young woman at the desk had upon them. They came before her growling like wolves and went away as meek and quiet as sheep. In fact, some of them had sheepish looks on their faces as they left, because the young woman's self-control had made them ashamed of themselves. Ever since I witnessed that scene, I have thought of the poise and self-control of that young woman at the desk every time I felt myself becoming irritated at remarks which I did not like. And often I have thought that everybody should have a set of mental earmuffs which they could slip over their ears at times. Personally, I've developed the habit of closing my ears against much of the idle chatter such as I used to make it my business to resent. Life is too short, and there is too much constructive work to be done to justify us in striking back at everyone who says that which we do not wish to hear. In the practice of law, I have observed a very clever trick that trial lawyers use when they wish to get a statement of facts from a belligerent witness who answers questions with the proverbial, "I do not remember," or "I do not know." When everything else fails, they manage to make such a witness angry, and in this state of mind they cause him to lose his self-control and make statements that he would not have made had he kept a cool head. Most of us go through life with our weather eye cast skyward in quest of trouble. We usually find that for which we are looking. In my travels, I have been a student of men whom I have heard in Pullman car conversation, and I have observed that practically 9 out of every 10 have so little self-control that they will invite themselves into the discussion of almost any subject that may be brought up. But few men are contented to sit in a smoking compartment and listen to a conversation without joining in and airing their views. Once I was traveling from Albany to New York City. On the way down, the smoking car club started a conversation about the late Richard Croker, who was then chief of Tammany Hall. The discussion became loud and bitter. Everyone became angry except one old gentleman who was agitating the argument and taking a lively interest in it. He remained calm and seemed to enjoy all the mean things the others said about the tiger of Tammany Hall. Of course, I supposed that he was an enemy of the Tammany chief, but he wasn't. He was Richard Croker himself. This was one of his clever tricks through which he found out what people thought of him and what his enemies' plans were. Whatever else Richard Croker might have been, he was a man of self-control. Perhaps that is one reason why he remained undisputed boss of Tammany Hall as long as he did. Men who control themselves usually boss the job, no matter what it may be. Please read again the last sentence of the preceding paragraph, for it carries a subtle suggestion that might be of profit to you. This is a commonplace incident, but it is in just such incidents that the great truths of life are hidden. Hidden because the settings are ordinary and commonplace.